maybe about 10 years now, even my best JPEG images, I already have hundreds and thousands of photos that I consider good shots. There's no way in hell I'm going to go back to my old raw photos and reprocess them. Like, it's, and also, it's a philosophical thing too, is that a lot of the reason why we store our old images is that we get FOMO that we might miss a good shot. That could be our Nat Geo winning shot. However, I think as a photographer, the photos you have not yet shot are more important than the photos you have already shot. Which means as a photographer, you always need to be looking forward and thinking about, to really truly grow as a photographer, don't think about your old pictures, always think about your new pictures. So even realize as a photographer, your style and your approach in photography is always changing, it's always evolving, and you're in a state of flux. Like even our human biology, our the atoms in our body are constantly changing. So from a philosophical perspective, don't worry so much about hoarding everything. So you ever watch that TV show Hoarders?
Yeah.
So what do these people do?
They hoard.
The big stress in my life right now is I'm contemplating buying a big NAS drive because I have so many freaking...
Don't do that.
You know, storage is so cheap.
That's right.
NAS is a good idea.
No, wait, okay, storage is cheap. Do you know what's not cheap?
Time.
Your time and your attention.
No, so this is why I rank. So I, not all my pictures, because I haven't gone to the previous one to do this, but from like the past 2 years I've been ranking, and I've been pretty good at trying to rank what I like. So if I were to run out of space for some reason, I would just delete 1, 2, 3s and keep 4s and 5s.
Yeah, no, you're totally right, because honestly, with Google Photos now, you pretty much have unlimited photo cloud storage. Like, literally unlimited. It's, yeah. You don't have to cost, storage doesn't cost anything. Storage is free now. Because you can even download the Google Photos app on your laptop or your camera or your phone, whatever. You have unlimited photos synced to draw these, to Google Photos. So now the issue we're dealing from a philosophical perspective is, assuming we all live to be 100 years old, right? I'd say, or 120. Data is cheap, information is cheap, your time and your attention isn't. That's your most valuable asset. It's your time, your attention, your energy. Because these are all non-renewable resources. Because, and now I'm going to go deep philosophy on the West, right? Every single day we're marching closer to death, right? And what you have to think about as a photographer artist is that how am I going to best meaningfully use my time in what I consider a meaningful and impactful way? And how am I going to not essentially waste my time? So, in the past, I wasted too much time thinking about my past pictures and how to archive or whatever. Just think about the future, because even once again, ultimately, if you die as a photographer and you have one meaningful photo that's impacted the world in a positive way, you've done your job as a photographer. And
Yep. My job isn't to impact the world. My job is to enjoy what I'm doing as I go along in the world. I don't care if any of my photos ever impact the world. That's not my goal in life. My goal in life is to enjoy the process of taking pictures, and if I share them with people that I love or know, and they enjoy what I'm doing because I want to share, then that's great. But I don't need to impact the world.
Oh, okay. So you're totally right. So when I say the world, I mean, as long as you can impact one other human being on planet Earth, either today alive or in the future, I think you've done your job as a human. So that's why I think it's important, not only for us photographers to do meaningful work that's meaningful to us, but I think it's also very important for us to share. So sharing is really tricky as a photographer because it's more important to share our pictures with people who are really meaningful to us, even though it might be like 10 people, than share it with 5 billion people, right? So this is why I'm kind of anti-Instagram, is that we're sharing it with like this ambiguous crowd of people on the internet, but we're not actually sure who we're really, really want to impress. Because I think as photographers, it's better to impress 3 photographers whose opinion matter to you rather than impress 5 million people who are not that important to you. So I think, once again, when I say make photos that will impact the world, I think even if you could make a photo and share with a person that deeply impacts them and then ends up inspiring them in a positive way, I think you've done your job as a photographer. art or human being artist. And so even now I'm starting to have this issue that like I have too many pictures. And sometimes I feel like I want, so in the ideal world, I want my viewer, my ideal viewer, to know every single of my great pictures and know it by heart as much as I do, but in reality that ain't happening, right? So even now I'm pretty proud that like I think I have at least 3 meaningful pictures or impactful photos, many of these which are the covers here. And what I like to do for archival purposes is create these digital contact sheets. So in the days of film, you could spread out 36 images of one roll of film, and that was very easy to archive. With digital now, this is actually very difficult. But I like to do this as a learning tool, and I share this with people on the internet. But also I do it for my own purposes, because sometimes I'm just kind of curious to see how it worked a scene. So in this series of images that I photographed with Cindy, you can see the way I generally work the scene is I'm kind of dancing with my subject. Is I'm making many photos, some photos with flash, some without flash. So you can see with flash, without flash. I have no idea what's going to look like until I just shoot it, right? And Cindy's also a very good model. She knows how to pose, look different directions. And I'm just kind of working the scene, and you really never know what the good shot is until you shoot it, right? So I think I ended up liking this one because I like the halo around her, and I like the mystery of this swooped on her face. And you never really know what's going to be your best shot until you go home, you sit down in front of your computer, and then you spend the time to look through your images. Basic ideas that I'll give you to better choose your best pictures is this. So you guys can write this down on a piece of paper. So this is Eric Kim's image selection algorithm. This is like me giving you the keys of Google algorithm. Okay. So I judge a photograph by 3 criteria. Number one, composition. Number two, emotion. And number 3, soul. In that order. So to make good compositions is the easiest part. The second most difficult part is to put emotions in a photo. The last most important thing is to show your own soul in your own pictures. Because ultimately the pictures you show of other people, the pictures you shoot are not about the other people in your photo. The photos are about yourself. Because you as a photographer, you're essentially a filter, is that you decide what to photograph and what not to photograph. Meaning, if I'm walking down the street with Anthony, and Anthony photographs the kid with the balloon, but I photograph the homeless dude, like, passed on the ground, it shows something different about our own personality, our own soul, the way we see the world. Because we technically walked down the same street, we saw the same 2 things, but I decided to photograph the homeless guy, whereas Anthony decided to photograph the kid with, you know, balloons. And perhaps what it reveals about my soul is that I'm more attracted to, like, more pessimistic outlook in life, perhaps, and then you might see more joy and happiness in life. And as a photographer, it all comes down to your perspective, is that your perspective of the world in terms of how you see the world in a positive, perhaps, or a negative way, and also your perspective in terms of composition, where are you standing and how are you framing the scene? I think this is going to be the most important thing as a photographer, your perspective. On an emotional perspective, composition perspective, as well as what does your photo say about your soul? So even nowadays, like, I look at so many pictures from other people, I don't really care if the composition's so good or not, I don't really care if they got a lot of followers. To only me, the only important thing I care about when I look at another photographer's work is, do I see their soul in the photo? Because even, I'm really into reading poetry, and I'm really into reading, like, for example, Horace or Virgil. Even though they wrote this like 2,000 years ago, I could still hear their voice and feel their soul through their poetry. Same thing with Leonardo da Vinci or Raphael. I could feel their emotions and their souls through every single brushstroke they create. And I think even as photographers, we're trying to, after we're dead, hopefully there's a little bit of our soul that remains in our pictures that will continue to reverberate. So even my laughing lady picture. The way I was able to make this photograph was I essentially put my soul in the picture because I talked to her, I engaged her, and I laughed with her. And the way I was able to make the photograph was I engaged her. So how many photos did I shoot?
29.
40.
Okay. If I just took one picture and pieced out, would I have got the shot?
No.
If I only took 15 photos, would I have got the shot?
What city was this?
Yes.
New York. I guess
it's possible. Okay. So I'll play you guys through the play-by-play. So, oh, excuse me, miss, you look so amazing, can't photograph you. She said, yeah, sure. Click, this is all Rico. Click, 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 click. Some with flash, some without flash. And I said, can you look down? Oh, can you look up? So you can see the light looks good, nice. I did -1 or -2 exposure composition. So you can see the blacks look good and the skin tones look good. And so I'm clicking, clicking, clicking. And then she's like, you're so crazy. Like, you're a crazy Asian tourist taking so many photos. And then I'm like this close, shooting macro mode, right? And then click, 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 click. And I was shooting all this in RAW, actually, I think at the time. And the buffer on the Ricoh GR2 is actually very slow. So I was just shooting in blacked out mode, because at this point my camera's buffer couldn't keep up. And so the reason why I think this is a great photograph, you know, I think the composition, emotion, everything's fine. But it really, to me, I think shows my soul is that, you know, I'm a funny, happy, exuberant guy, and I was able to elicit this reaction out of her. So some people might say, oh, like, that's not a genuine picture because of da 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 da. But I'm like, I feel it's genuine because it genuinely shows Eric Kim's emotion and soul embedded in this person. So the person is actually a vessel for you. This is my theory. So any street photo you shoot of other people, you're trying to convey who you are as a photographer and an individual. In terms of keeping everything organized in Lightroom, because I also want to give you guys some practical tips, generally the best way to do it is this. When you're looking through your pictures, there's many different ways you could do. So I'll give you guys some practical tips. Tip number one, look at your photos backwards. Meaning, don't look at the photos you shot from the very beginning and look through the pictures, right? My suggestion is look backwards. Look at the photos you shot most recently in time. and then go backwards. Because generally, this is my theory, is that as you're photographing, so you remember this wall here and then shot a bunch of photos. So I shot a bunch of pictures of people next to this wall, and you know, I didn't know if I was going to get a good picture or not, but I just kept working the scene, and some pictures with Cindy. So even like, let me give you an example, there's all these photos I shot of Cindy against this lady in the wall, right? Generally, not always, but generally the photos towards the end are the best pictures, because you've worked the scene and you're kind of experimenting with your compositions as you're working. So then what I'll also do too is that I'll increase the thumbnails. And if you want to look at the photos very quickly, you can do a grid 3x3. So make the images on thirds to better see the composition. Or what you're going to do too is start on the very last series of the pictures. And then what I like to do is full screen the picture to press F. And then I'll just use the arrow key and go backwards to look at the pictures. And to be able to determine what photo I like, I would just say, it sounds so silly, but just follow your gut. Well, that's kind of interesting. So like, to me, this feels very surreal because of the hand. And then whenever I see a picture I like, I just press P for pick, and I'll just keep going back. And sometimes, in a certain scene, you might see more than one picture that you like, and then you'll P more than one picture, and then afterwards you can look at it. So I was lucky enough that I looked at that series of images and I liked it. And you see down here in this corner here, I would always recommend you to play with a thumbnail size, because you can even determine what's a good composition based on seeing these as small thumbnails. So you can even see here, right? Is even this composition here, it's kind of interesting is that you have the eye in the top right corner, you have Cindy in the bottom right corner, you have the nose, and you got the hand that's kind of curved like this. Whereas other pictures, you could even see as small thumbnails, they're not quite so good. Like, this picture, there's just a lady walking away, it's a little bit boring. Even you could determine what the optimal French fry composition based on seeing these as small thumbnails. And you could even see the impact of colors too, or the different photographs you shot, like, oh, these are interesting red photos. So sometimes even what you could do as a fun assignment is look at your photos as thumbnails, like a 3x3 thumbnail, and just quickly scroll through all your pictures so you don't have to look at the photos full screen. I think three images across is kind of optimal based on my eyes. And so I'll just kind of scroll through the pictures. And this is, so for example, this is some pictures I shot of like bed sheets. And I'm like, oh, this kind of looks like, and this is random too. I was studying Leonardo da Vinci. He was so obsessed with sketching
folded
clothes. But to us photographers, very easy because it's like quickly created. So you could just kind of look at these pictures as small thumbnails and you're like, oh, which one is nice? Another pro tip is if you want to turn off the lights, the hotkey to turn off the lights is L. And if you press L once, it makes it a little bit dark. You press L twice, it makes it very dark. So you could even see these as small thumbnails like this. And even for fun, what you can do is you can scroll through them. You can just kind of keep scrolling through them. And then whenever you see something that catches your eye, see, usually the best ones are the best. And for them, you just click it and just press P to pick it. If I turn on the lights again, it's a little bit hard to see, but you can see like there's a little pick indicator. And I'll show you guys in a bit how to filter it. So once again, you could just honestly just kind of scroll through your pictures because I have freaking 1,600 photos here shot over 2 days. This is the curse of digital photography. Is you're wasting your time to look through like a freaking trillion photographs, right? So you can just kind of, honestly at this point, the easiest way I would just recommend is just scroll through your photos mindlessly. And whenever you see anything that remotely interests you, just click it and press P. Just kind of scroll through it, and then if you look at my workshop photos, scroll through it backwards, could even be more effective than looking at time. Scroll through it. And at this point, just follow your gut. So I kind of like this picture immediately because this face against this guy here. So I'll press P and press G to go back to gallery view. Scroll. I actually kind of like this. To me, this feels like modern art. Like these shapes here. Well, I kind of like that.
I saw you taking that.
Yeah. So it's actually funny because the more experience I get as a photographer, the more newbie I can be. This is your picture. So, yeah, so I'll just kind of keep scrolling. Oh, if you guys want to see the contact sheets here.
I think we're okay. Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Right? We don't need the fan?
No, we don't.
Yeah, thanks so much, Kevin.
Oh, so I'll show you guys some behind the scenes. So this was our best friend here. Here's the behind the scenes of what was happening. But then that's how I took the picture. And, yeah. So these are all the pictures. So you can just kind of scroll through the pictures. And let's say you've gone through all your pictures and you've peed all the photos you like. Then in the bottom right corner where it says filters off, click this and click flagged. So down here, click flagged. And then, boom, you'll instantly filter all of your best pictures. And then what I recommend to do afterwards is then you can figure out the time how to post-process your picture. So I'll click this, and if you want to develop the photo, press D to go under develop. And I have a bunch of presets. I can also email these to you, but you can just Google AirCam presets. You can see them on my blog for free. And another thing I like to personally do is I'm trying to create my own certain artistic aesthetic style. And I'm like obsessive with it is, you see, I'm creating this new chroma preset that creates colors that I like. And I'm always so dissatisfied, I can't make it look quite the way I wanted to. So I'm version 39. But this one here actually looks pretty good. So I'll just click this to apply it. But let's say I didn't like this. I'll show you how to make a new preset. You just click this. Let's say I added more contrast. Like, okay, that looks pretty good to me. Then what I just do is right click, rename, Command C to copy this naming convention, and then scroll up to the top, presets, create preset, and now I'll just title this Eric Kim Chroma version 40, V40. But essentially what I wanted to say is that I think presets are the best because presets will help you develop a certain aesthetic and look to reflect them. Okay, that looks, and this is another big tip. In terms of post-processing, you can spend freaking like 20 hours post-processing one photo. Ain't nobody got time for that. Once you get a photo to look 80% aesthetically good to you, just stop. Because I think there's a saying is, or how do you say this? Raise your hand if you like to cook. So, processing photos is like seasoning your food. Okay. What is the number one mistake in seasoning your food?
Over-seasoning it.
Because once you over-season it, can you under-season it?
No.
Obviously, with digital photography with raw images, you could unseason it, whatever. But the problem is that, like, if you spend too much time post-processing your photos, it becomes too over-seasoned and just like, right? And I'm bad because I actually like to over-season my food. Cindy knows. But so this looks pretty good to me. This one too. Okay, so I look at this, and now I'll just apply a preset that I already have.
But in digital, you just undo it.
Yeah, that's true. But I mean, I'm just using an analogy. So
one thing I was gonna mention is, it seems like it's nice to use the presets.
Yeah.
Because for instance, if I do a trip somewhere,
yeah.
I like to edit, and if I start editing all the photos,
the presets and stuff like that. But if you're on the Ricoh GR2 for color, just shoot high contrast, color positive film. It actually already looks really good. Same thing with the Fujifilm cameras. I really like the classic chrome look. So if you could get JPEGs to look the way you do, if you don't have to post-process, I think that's the best. Because once again, we're drawn in images. And in terms of post-processing, yeah, usually what I'll do is I'll just apply a preset. And then you just kind of drag it to the left and right. And then once it looks or feels the way you want it to, you could just export. And the easiest way to export images is select images. So you can either hold shift or you could just hold command and click many images. In the bottom left corner where it says export here, just click export. Then you figure out where you want to export it to. So what you want to do is just select the folder, so choose. I choose Dropbox, Pictures, 2018, and then I made a folder already called San Francisco version 1. But let's say I want San Francisco version 2. I'll click here, new folder, SFV2, create, choose. And this is actually very important. So by default, I don't think this is renamed or anything. Click rename to. Custom name sequence. So what that means is, custom name, you can put a custom name to it. In sequence, it'll just say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Which means if you open up your pictures in your Finder or your Explorer, it will actually show you in the correct order what you want. There's a trillion ways you can do this, but I just found this to be the most simple. Once you click custom name sequence, for your custom text, this is a very basic thing I would do. First and last name, the city in which you're in, the camera you use, and the year. So for example, Eric Kim Street Photography - San Francisco - Lumix G9 - 2018. And then I just click export. But before I do that, I'd recommend JPEG. Quality 80%. 80% is actually 100%. This is kind of lying to you. In Photoshop, when you do 10 out of 10, that's Lightroom's 80%. Because now in Photoshop, you have the option to do your image quality 12 out of 10, which makes no sense. That's essentially it's 100%.
So I've done full res testing, blah blah. 80% is optimal because it's the maximum image quality for the smallest size.
So in Photoshop, it's 10 out of 12?
Yeah, so 80 in Lightroom is equivalent to 10 out of 10 in Photoshop. If you made Lightroom 100, that's equivalent to 12 out of 10 in Photoshop. Does that make sense? So essentially, in simple words, keep this at 80, and you won't have 50 megabit images, you'll have it smaller. I just click sharpen to screen, standard. It's just a default setting I use. And this is actually a fun thing I like to do too, is under, after export, you click this. And you can click, so by default it's do nothing, but what I like to do is click show in Finder. Which means that after you export the image, your Finder menu will pop up. And then you could use those images to directly drag and drop to your blog or to whatever, however you want to shoot. So let's say I click this, I click export, and then it's thinking. Oh, another thing about Lightroom too, you only need to know how to use 10% of it for 90% of the functionality. So everything I showed you right now, that's literally all I do. I don't touch anything else. So now you can see my three pictures are here. And in terms of my personal workflow, after I do that, I'll make a new tab. Let's say I'm doing a new blog post on my WordPress. And then afterwards, what I'll do is I'll just kind of drag those images there and click. Okay, I'm gonna go there. Anyways, but now you can see all the pictures uploaded in this folder here. Or if I want to show you the directory, it's Dropbox, Pictures 2018, SF version 2, and you have these pictures. So once again, Dropbox, Pictures 2018, San Francisco version 2, and then I have all the images here. And then I can use that. So you can see, this is the benefit. Once you export the images, the reason why you want to do a custom name is that if you upload your photos, preferably to your website, not Facebook or Instagram, to your website or your blog portfolio, down the line, if someone searches Google Images, like, you know, Xiaoyu Photography or something, right? Google will know to look for your pictures because you put the file name. And also for your own personal archival purposes down the line, if you want to find a photo that you shot in San Francisco, you can just click here in Finder and search San Francisco, and it'll show you all your San Francisco photos easily. So I think this is actually a very underutilized function that a lot of photographers don't use. And once again, this is the thing, if I give you guys one homework assignment is after the workshop, make your own website portfolio. Not Instagram, not Facebook, because that shit is not archival. Your own website. Because even now, all the internet is being archived and indexed by Google. If you want to present your work in a meaningful way, the website is the ultimate way to go. Simple services to use. What I would recommend is sign up on bluehost.com. It's a website domain, so essentially it's like the website that houses your website. And then when you sign up for bluehost.com, it's like 10, 20 bucks a month, I don't know what it is. And then install WordPress.org. WordPress.org is an open source free software frame that allows you to upload pictures and blog and blah, 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 blah. That's everything that my whole website is run on.
What's it called? Blue what?
So Bluehost.com. And then when you sign up for Bluehost.com, you can register your own domain name, which is your own website address. So if you want to do like xiaoyuphotography.com, sign up for Bluehost.com. Check if xiaoyuphotography.com is available. Register for that. Then there's an option, install WordPress.org. And then you can install themes, and then you could upload your pictures to that. Because that's going to be the best way you can archive your photos for the future, and you actually own your content.
What about SmugMug or Squarespace, or like that?
No. Yeah. The reason is that, once again, it's...
I own the domain. I own all my pictures.
Yeah, yeah, no, so you're right, is that you do own your pictures, you own the domain, but if you use Smung or Squarespace, thinking from a long-term archival perspective, is not as indexable by Google in the long term. And not only that, but if one day SmugMug or Squarespace wants to change their user interface, you cannot not have them change it. Whereas with WordPress or open source frameworks, you have more control and customization. So, yeah, so I would still recommend for long-term perspectives, learning WordPress is still something that's going to help you so much.
Frank, I have a question about the name.
It just takes so much time. So I think what you're trying to do as a photographer is best effectively use your time and your resources to balance curating your portfolio, going out and taking pictures, and also editing your pictures. It's a very difficult cycle. And so, once again, smugmug.com is really good, as well as Squarespace and these other services are good. But I would still just like, this is just advice I wish I'd give myself. If you're thinking about long-term archival purposes, to do WordPress.org, and then it's more compatible with Google. And honestly, at this point, Google controls all information. And if you want things to be indexed by Google images in an optimized fashion, WordPress.org is the way to go. And I could even say too, the only reason I'm famous isn't because of my Facebook or social media stuff, it's because of the blog. And you've all probably found me by Googling street photography onto Google. If you want people to discover your photos more easily, ultimately they're going to Google you at one point or another. The more indexable you can make yourself by Google, the more likely your chances of long-term thrivival, it's a word of it. It's not survival, thrivival, because you want to thrive as photographers and artists, right? And, so that's good advice. Oh, and also, this is a plug for my entrepreneurship workshop 2 weekends from now. We're actually going to spend a lot of time doing website building and optimization, stuff like that. So if you're interested, just email me and let me know afterwards. So this is the very basic workflow for Lightroom. Essentially, it doesn't matter if you use Lightroom or Photos or whatever. The principles are still the same. So in your notebooks, write down some more stuff. I'm going to give some more tips. Okay, these are Eric Kim-isms. Tip one for editing. So these are editing tips. And when I say editing, I don't mean post-processing. I mean editing, choosing your best images. Tip number one, when in doubt, throw it out. Have you guys ever had milk in the fridge? When you're like, not quite sure if it's bueno or not, what would your mother say?
Toss.
I made the wrong mistake because I'm still in cheap, scrappy college student mode. I'm like, it always smells a bit sour. Next bro, oh Cindy, why did I do that to myself? And she's like, I told you. Right? So tip one. When in doubt, throw it out. If you're looking through your pictures and you're not sure if it's a good picture or not, it's not a good picture. And honestly, I think all of us in the room, we're at least going to probably live to be another 40, 50 years, right? You got 50 trillion photos you have not shot yet, perhaps. If your photo is not instantly recognizable by you as a good shot, or something that doesn't hit you in the chest, tricky lights. Like, if you see a good picture, it hits you in the chest, right? If it's kind of like a meh, it's a no good, right? So once again, look at your photos. If you're not quite sure if it's good or not, when in doubt, throw it out. Okay? Tip number two. If you're not sure if the composition is good or not, this is the small thumbnail test. So in Lightroom, or you can do this on your iPhone or whatever, drag the thumbnail slider to make your images really, really small to really, really judge if your composition is good or not, right? So I'm looking at these pictures, right?
This composition is still pretty good, right? Even this one? This one's not bad either. These ones here start to get a little bit jumbled. That's pretty good, it's pretty good, pretty good. This one's pretty minimalist. You guys remember, I stole somebody's photo. You guys remember this photo? So I just took my camera and I just shot from a high angle, looking up. So like minimalist, right? Just simple. But if you look at these photos as small thumbnails, you could judge how good the composition is. So that's a tip. Another fun tip, I'm gonna zoom in a little more. Flip your photos upside down. So this is another tip that I learned from my best friend, Henri Cartier-Bresson. He would take his contact sheets, prints, and look at his photos upside down, because when you flip your photos upside down, they no longer look like real pictures. And you can judge your compositions better when they don't look like pictures. So the way to do this is this. Command A to select your images or select all. And this is the tricky thing. On the keyboard, there's the command button in the bottom left corner. And then there's these weird symbols that look like the left and right brackets. It's next to the P button on the keyboard. So this is your keyboard, command button, QWERTY. There's a P button, right? And you know there's the left and the right brackets, those little weird things you never use. Right? So, so do you guys know these keys?
The brackets?
These are the bracket keys. So it's command plus. So this is the thing to rotate photos in Lightroom. So while holding command, you either press the left bracket, and then your photos will rotate that way. If you want them to rotate that way, you hold command, go, and then it'll rotate that way. So let me give you guys a demo. So here, while I'm holding command, I press left bracket, left bracket, left bracket, left bracket, right 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 bracket. So now, if I look at all my pictures upside down, kind of makes me feel a little carsick. I can still see it. This is like kind of an interesting composition because you can see the play of the white and the black. This one's still pretty good, this one's still pretty good, this one's pretty good, all these are pretty good. Not bad. This one's, now I can tell these are just too cluttered, too messy. Pretty good. Okay. So once again, command A, brackets, okay? So that's tip number two. The last tip actually, upload to this website that I made. So it's a startup I created called Ars Beta. Essentially it's a service to upload your photo to it. And then you'll have a bunch of people anonymously tell you whether you should keep or ditch the photo.
What's the
website's called Ars Beta. So arsbeta.com. Keep or ditch. So this is a website that essentially, it was my brainchild. Like, I thought, like, man, it's so frustrating. I have some photos I'm not sure whether I should keep or ditch. What if there's a website I could upload to it and then people could help me keep or ditch my photos, but they could do it in an anonymous way that won't hurt my feelings? So we created this, and then Cindy, and my friend Kevin, who's like a cloud computer engineer at Google, and also Annette, has been building it up. So essentially, you upload the photo to the platform, and then you could just keep or ditch the picture. So it's just an easy way to crowdsource your photos instead of having to put on Instagram. So I'll also email a link to Ars Beta again, but it's a really cool thing for you to set up. You can sign up for free with your Google account and just upload pictures. Just kind of play around with it. So that's the basic fundamentals of Lightroom. Honestly, once again, to keep things simple with Lightroom, you just gotta keep it simple. I think, also, things for you guys to consider, this was an interesting conversation we had this morning, is, so in photography there's many different processes, right? There's a process of going out and shooting, there's a process of going home and choosing your best images, editing down to which one you suppose you like your best, Then there's the post-processing, adding the filters, black and white, contrast, blah, blah, blah. And then there's the sharing part of your pictures, right? So these are all different phases of your photography. Some of us like certain parts and some of us don't like certain parts. So for some of us, we really like the post-processing part of it, right? Some of us, like myself, I actually don't. But I'm actually quite keen on the editing part. But also a lot of people don't like that either. So figure out what part of photography, which parts of photography you really like, and focus on that. And for the other stuff that's not as important to you, try to minimize it as much as possible. So if you're the type of person, you don't like to post-process, you like to touch Lightroom or Photoshop, whatever, just shoot JPEGs. If you really love it, shoot RAW and then spend a lot of time working on it. If you don't like none of it, you just want to shoot, maybe it's best to just use your phone, honestly. Like, there's nothing wrong with shooting your phone. I've been shooting a lot with my phone recently too, it's fun. So you can shoot a lot, right? Or if you're the type of person who likes to spend a lot of time editing, looking at your pictures, choosing the best ones, print out your best photos as 4x6s. You could print them on Costco or Walgreens or mpix.com. It's another website I like. And then you can edit down your portfolio, choose your best images. And also the sharing part too. You might only want to WeChat or Facebook Messenger your best photos to your friends and family. Or you might want to put on Instagram or your website or whatever. Ultimately, there's no right or wrong way to do any of these things. Just sit down and be very honest with yourself and be like, which phases of these do I really want to focus on? So for myself, for example, currently, I like all of it, except I really don't like the post-processing part. That's why I'm trying to make a preset that I can just apply one preset to all my images without having to think about it. And an easy way to batch apply one preset to all your images is once you've selected all your images, you can press Command A to select all your images. And make sure you're under the library function. Top here, under Saved Presets, you click this little button here. And then you go under User Presets or wherever. And then you just choose one preset that you want to apply to all your pictures. So I made this Eric Kim Chroma version 40. And just click that. And then Lightroom will automatically apply, batch apply the presets to all the photos. And then once you apply a photo, then you open the picture, and then you could just adjust the exposure, minus or plus. But once about 80% good enough, just stop. Just minus exposure. And that's honestly all I do nowadays is I just play with the exposure. Well, I apply a preset, and then I just change the exposure a little bit. Right? Alright, cool. So that's just a basic fundamental overview. Questions?
I got one. Is there a reason that you use, that I see you're using Lightroom CC versus, or Lightroom Classic CC versus Lightroom CC? Did you try Lightroom CC?
Oh, so Lightroom's, okay, so Adobe made our lives very complicated. Bastards. So Adobe has an interesting challenge. A lot of people like to edit their photos on their phones and iPads. So, but then this stuff is way too much to put on your iPad, right? So they made a new program called Adobe Lightroom CC, which is supposed to be syncs perfectly between your iPad, your iPhone, your laptop, whatever, right? It's pretty good.
Don't use it.
But in my practice, I've discovered the classic OG is still the best.
Like, it's impressive. I've played with Brown with both, but like, everyone, like, I found there was a few things missing.
Yeah, so the new version CC, just, I still think it's really good, and it's really good for iPad and iPhone, but still, if you really want to choose the simplest, this is actually the ironic thing, is that it looks, on the outside, it looks more complex, because there's too many freaking options and stuff, but in terms of workflow, in terms of selecting your images, exporting and renaming it, it's still the fastest. So I experimented a lot with Lightroom, the new Lightroom CC. In terms of speed, I waste less time using this in my personal experience.
So you're suggesting Lightroom Classic?
Yeah, use Lightroom Classic.
And is this a subscription service?
Yeah, it's like $10 a month.
$10 a month.
Yeah, I drop it.
Yeah. And honestly, you might even use, so that's a problem. They might phase it out in the future, so we're going to be screwed. Honestly, even if you use Apple Photos is good. Mm-hmm. I like Apple Photos. If you want to keep it simple and just use Apple Photos, that's totally cool too.
Cool.
Yeah. I might try to do some more experimenting with Apple Photos, to be honest, because I'm kind of a little worried that Adobe's probably going to axe this
Yeah, but it's nowhere near the features that it has.
Yeah. That's true. The thing with photos is that you really got to lean on those plugins that they can do. Because there's some plugins
out there, like raw conversion
stuff.
It's because, I mean, Apple Photos is great too, because you look through your pictures and you can just instantly heart what you like. It's the same thing as adding P here. And then you could look at your folders and favorite images, and then you could... this is one program I like to use on a phone or iPad. It's called VSCO. It's a free app. And the presets I really like is this A6 preset. It looks really good for color. It makes it look like old school color film.
VS.
VSCO.
I think there's another reason not to use Apple Photos.
Yeah.
Oh.
As far as I know, they don't have a way for you to do store locally. So eventually, all your pictures are synced with the cloud. That's fine. The price is about the same. But if you have old pictures, those are essentially not cacheable.
Yeah. So
whereas with Adobe, you can say, I want this to be local.
Yeah.
And it will stay local forever.
But, so this is what you do. If you use Apple Photos on your desktop, whatever, once you have chosen a photo you like good in Apple Photos, export it as a JPEG and store that JPEG to Dropbox.
Yeah, I guess that's
fine.
Because there's all this silly talk about, I mean, you're the engineer, so you know, there's all this talk about like, oh, you don't need files anymore because you have the cloud. No, we still want files.
I mean, local files.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Or, yeah, local files or also files anywhere. We want files. The more JPEGs, the more PDFs, the better.
The biggest issue I have with Lightroom is if they crash it, if next version has issues, you might, you know, not be able to access until there's a fix.
So this also, you're totally wrong, right, too. Because when you use Lightroom Classic CC or Lightroom whatever, it creates a Lightroom category, a Lightroom catalog. These catalog files often get corrupted, and then you're fucked.
Yeah.
That's why it's so simple, but exporting as JPEGs and just storing those JPEGs, or even, I mean, the safest thing is just to print them out. But JPEGs are the future. JPEGs and PDFs.
They're actually very smart. They have, it's not just...
Number one. On, and then the number one. They're photo raw.
Okay, you guys could give that a Google.
That program, because it's not subscription.
Okay.
And they don't catalog it the same way, so they have a browser that uses a browser to your photos. So you just download your photos, you browse it, and then you edit it, and it's actually an excellent program. They're doing a lot of really good stuff.
Isn't there
another one that's like very popular these days?
Capture One.
Keyboard, I just pressed the number 5 to give it 5 stars. So for me, my heart key is this. Nothing, P, like fucking my best photos, I'll add a 5-star.
Yeah.
I just try to keep it as simple as possible, because there's other ways you can use Lightroom. You can add like 2 stars, 3 stars, 4 stars, 5 stars, and if that works for you, that's cool. But once again, based on my personal experience, striving for optimal simplicity, it's either nothing, pick, or 5, or nothing at all. I'm like obsessed with simplicity. I'm like, because you guys know the acronym KISS, KISS?
Keep it simple. Simple, stupid.
I like keep it simple. Silly. Yes, I don't know, ain't nobody like to be called stupid. Yeah. So I'm very silly and very stupid at the same time, so I like to keep it simple, keep it simple, keep it simple.
Now, I use my NAS to back up my Dropbox. So I have a local version of the Dropbox.
Yeah, so that's
back up Google Drive too.
Yeah,
I mean, I always do local.
So that's super cool. But yeah, honestly, like file backup, it's honestly at this point it's more of a philosophy than an approach. Right? What time is it?
4:13.
4:13. Okay.
How did you create the contact sheets?
Oh, how did I create a contact sheet? Okay, let me show you. So in Lightroom, I'm gonna uncheck my filters. So to go back to this whole thing. So first of all, you have to select what you want to create as part of your contact sheet, right? So for me, it's this picture, this picture, this picture, this picture. Okay. So since I've already selected this image here, what I'll do is I'll hold the Shift key on my keyboard and I'll press the left arrow
left arrow, left arrow, left arrow. Okay? So these images now are selected. Now in the top right corner where it says print, I'll click that. Okay. And now all the way here on the left where it says 4x5 contact sheet or 5x8 contact sheet, you click one of these filters here. Yeah. You choose one of those. Then all the way in the bottom right corner here, scroll down. And this is the thing that's actually really tricky, is that okay, so under photo info, you don't want to do file name, you want to do sequence. Now you can see sequence, 1 out of 4, 2 out of 4, 3 out of 4, 4 out of 4, right? And then this is also really tricky, under print job, fucking hate Adobe, it's so complicated. You have to undrop this print job caret, and under print 2, you want this to be JPEG file. Okay? Click JPEG file. And then finally, oh god, I'm getting so tired, right? Print a file, and then you choose where. So this is still my San Francisco folder, I'll title it.
How's that any simpler than just creating a collection?
It's not, it's more complicated.
Yeah.
No, but to export a contact sheet.
You're exporting it to where?
A JPEG contact sheet. Yeah. So, like, let me show you guys. So let's say I save this, okay? Now I actually have a real file on my computer. So now you can see in my Dropbox under pictures 2018 SFT. This is busman contact sheet.jpg. So this is actually a JPEG file. And if I open up the JPEG file, this is just a JPEG file of all the pictures in my sequence. So I could share this JPEG file on Instagram or Facebook or my blog. Whereas a collection,
that's fine. I mean, I think this is doing a difference. You're using it for a different purpose.
Yeah. So the purpose of a contact sheet, for me at this point, is kind of more of an educational thing, because like since I'm a photography teacher and I just want to show people how I made my best photos. For that, to be honest, I think in today's world, like if you're not really planning on educating other people or if you're not crazy into archival, I think it's kind of a waste of time. To be honest. But it's still kind of fun.
Instagram has something called Boomerang. So,
and then I could have the screenshot. But the problem is that like, it just depends on how you want to make it look, right? Right. More questions. Right. You guys want to take a quick coffee break? Tips about branding, marketing yourself, blah 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 blah.
Where do you get your presets?
Google AirCam presets. Free.
Can you rap?
Huh?
Can you rap?
I can rap. I can rap and trap.
Somebody
from a rapper to a trapper, from a trapper to a snapper. Because I like to go off. I like to go old school in my main bag. Because I wear black on black on black. My money. Stacks on stacks on stacks. My friends. Also black on black on black. When I shoot, it's like clack, 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 clack. I'm on my Google Maps. I'm on track, 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 track.
AI?
AI. I'm the guy with the brain. My rhymes make the girls go insane. I'm going like a bullet train to Osaka. That's my OG place. I'm the number one place in the world because I don't go on a world tour. I just go on a twirl.
Shinkazen.
I'm very zen. I got lots of friends. I drop a Benz. I will make amends.
I got a lens.
I called him. Oh! Eminem in the room.
Wait for
him.
What's the next question?
All right.
Next question.
My new shutter
speed is 1.0.
What's next? What's your plans in the immediate future?
Plans in the immediate future? I want to do more. I want to get to more movie and film and direction and stuff like that. Okay, so guys, I'm going to show you guys something cool. So, we're all on the next level. So, you know, other photographers are very basic. We are on a new plane. PLANE. You're accruing lots of frequent flyer miles. Because PLANE sounds like PLANE, frequent flyer. Okay.
Got it.
So a good way to present your work is actually to just make slideshows. So someone mentioned slideshow, and I just want to show you how you can make a super basic slideshow. Raise your hand if you own a Mac. Raise your hand if you do not own a Mac. I'm so sorry. pretend like you own one. You can play along. Okay. So. We have this free program called iMovie that you guys might not know. And a very basic homework assignment I can give you guys is this. After the workshop, choose your best, however so many images you want to choose, and make a simple slideshow, add some music to it, and just upload to YouTube and just send us a link. To me, I was actually inspired by Cindy to do slideshow because music adds another layer to your photos. So for example, let's say you had musics.
Oh.
Yep.
Show them Tokyo Dance.
Okay. So this is what Cindy did. You don't have to do this because Sydney is really epic, but then this is an idea of what one can do.
Tokyo lens.
All photos by Sydney.
Do you still remember how to rustle, shake, and dance to the melody of wind and sky? Or do your concrete mirrors only know how to stand still, bitter, and silent?
Try to
come. Can I hold you forever closely? In this tender moment, but forgetting you will make finding you oh so much sweeter. A morning whisper, mechanical steps lead me somewhere I once was.
Is that in Tokyo?
Yay! So, to give you guys a sense, so all of us are visual artists, right? So don't just constrain yourself to still pictures. You can even take your pictures and just make it into a slideshow or just play around with it in Final Cut, or you can just keep it super basic. So Cindy shows me with, she made all the beats, the music, whatever. It's a very cool way you could. Don't just restrain yourself to just photography. There's different ways you do it. Cindy's really good at Final Cut Pro. She taught herself everything. I'm super basic. I don't know how to do none of that. So I'm going to show you something that I actually like. So I just took my favorite pictures. So essentially, I made a slideshow, and I just want you to watch it and listen to the music and just see how it makes you feel. This is my grandfather's series. This is documenting his funeral before and after.
There's one word that comes to mind.
What?
Melancholy.
Who?
Melancholy.
What?
Melancholy.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
The music's been on top. Yeah. So I think this is
Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind.
Where is this?
This is all Busan, Korea, South Korea. So essentially, I documented my grandfather's funeral. I shot this all in black and white film. Shot about 7 rolls of film. Chose my best friend, my mom. I'm having like emotional watching. So sad. But it's my mom. This is where she grew up. Her house doesn't exist anymore. Selfie.
Rico.
Yeah, Rico. Oh, chair one. Oh, you know her?
When was this?
These were like 3 years ago. He's a picture of Cindy.
But that's not in Korea, the last picture.
No, these are all Berkeley guys. Paris, what's coffee? Berlin.
That's hot enough?
This is our apartment in Berkeley, our favorite mirror from IKEA. Sunset, I asked her to hold up her hand. IKEA fold out the bed. Rico GR Digital. Rico GR Digital.
But you chose a lot of pictures, right?
Because yeah, I chose a lot. Yeah.
So usually like 10 is a lot, right?
Yeah. So essentially what I wanted to do was, I wanted to create like some sort of story or narrative. So it starts off with my grandfather's death, and then it's called Death and Life. And now it's, you know, my...
Oh, so it's a rebirth. I see.
Yeah,
I see. Yeah.
Cindy's poem she wrote to me. So I shot my own wedding with a Rico GR2 digital in my pocket, and I documented it.
Did you have a second photographer?
Oh, no, I had a real photographer.
Okay.
Neil.
Okay. I like that word, like selfie.
Oh, yeah, I like selfie, yeah.
Is that your grandfather, Lolex?
Hopefully. Oh, yeah, it is actually.
Ah, that's fantastic.
It's from like the 1920s.
That looks like a Datejust. That's
fantastic. Yeah, Datejust. Oh, you know, okay, I get it.
Good man, that's how I get paid in photography.
Oh, nice, good man. Yeah. So now I'm starting to like make some like more about melancholy street photos. These are all just like random people's now. But you can see really it's. I think what creates the emotion is actually the music. These are all digital actually too. GR2, Eric Kim Monochrome 1600%.
That's one of your best. That's my favorite picture of yours. That's amazing.
It's my mom. It's Kyoto. Kyoto man. This is Provincetown, Massachusetts, Saigon. So essentially what I'm doing is, I made a point to only choose my black and white photos, which I feel like reflect this melancholy mood. And then I also chose the music to reflect this melancholy mood.
This is your grandma?
That was at Paris.
No, the hands was your family or no?
No, strangers.
These are all street photos.
Street photos, yeah. Yeah, so these are all strangers. Downtown LA.
That's amazing.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah.
Did you create that with some light, some stroke?
Oh, I shot with a flash, slow shutter speed.
Yeah. But how come the nose only got big?
Oh, because it was sunset. So,
oh, so that was already helping?
Yeah. So the nose, because the sunset, the nose looked super long because it had the wall. There was actually. She was standing here, and there's a wall in the corner, and then so the nose shadow was around the corner, so it made it actually look longer. So even like another series concept. So this is a series that I do. It's called like My America, Only America. I have a working title. Essentially, I had this problem. I downloaded all this music from the internet, and then I put it into my slideshows and I upload to YouTube. I keep getting this stupid copyright infringement.
Yep.
Things I'm like, oh, it's so annoying. I'm like, what did I do? I'm like, I don't want to pay for music. It's kind of, oh no, there's something called GarageBand. So I actually ended up making my own beats as a motivation to just add filler music to it. But now my music is actually getting pretty good. I can also show you how I make beats, but then also want to give you another example.
One quick thing, I mean, this is true, but there's also places where
you get royalty-free music. But then it's kind of nice that sometimes when life throws you lemons, make lemonade.
Yes.
So I was like, this copyright infringement is stupid, right? But I'm like, rather than just complaining about it, maybe I should
oh, I guess I could try, I can make my own music? Wait, oh yeah, I have this thing called GarageBand. So it became this positive feedback loop where I could just be more creative in a different way. So essentially for this, what I did was, this is kind of cool. I took my America series and I'm like, okay, I want to create music that reflects this melancholy mood I had with America. So I essentially made this. And this is all shot Kodak Portra 400 film, 35mm. Oh, that's where the beat gets good. So Detroit, Michigan, San Diego, somewhere, LA, Costco, LA, Cindy's Restaurant, American Critiques, right? In-N-Out, my favorite, there's Cindy. So you don't just photograph people, you photograph details too. Provincetown, Berkeley. So you can see, right, like, if you're working on a photo project, don't just shoot all just one picture. Kind of like variety, right? And you can see it's like America for leaves, right? So you can see America for sale, like, there's this very IKEA blatant imagery. Mission here. Orange County. I think it's a pretty good puppy. Maybe I'll hear a nice book. Texas? Yeah. Texas, I think, maybe? Not guilty of what that's in the name.
Oh my
God. Yeah. So, even photographing newspapers, because 5 years from now, it's going to be meaningful, for it. Berkeley. Black Ops. Childhood obesity. Apple Store. Vegas, Detroit, Chicago. Well, it's like Flash, right? Yeah, Flash, yeah. Berkeley. So you can see, right, like, I'm trying to show, like, imagery of, like, this is McDonald's, like, photographing Ray's, like, kind of this, like, snarky,
critique. How did you get that first, that, maybe it's like second or third picture?
Oh, this guy?
No, about this guy.
Wait, sorry, what's the question?
You have a picture of somebody in a hoodie,
yeah,
like a KKK, next to like a photography of a black person being gay.
How
did you do this?
That picture.
That's not true. That's
that picture
that's
was. I was at the Henry Ford Museum in Detroit. It was just an exhibit.
Oh, so it's a picture of a picture.
Yeah, but then I shot with a flash to create that.
Richard,
thank you so much.
It's so
hot.
Wait,
a lot of fun.
We gotta do a selfie, man. Let's do a
selfie.
Yeah,
selfie. On this thing, huh?
Okay. Two cameras in one day. Like you
no,
have
just one camera, one lens.
And you're
one camera, one lens. Or else you're gonna be so distracted.
Yeah.
So I just have my film Black MP around my neck. That's the only camera I shot with for like about 2 years. That and 35mm f/2 lens, Kodak Portra 400.
Uh-huh. And then you ditched that, and then you went Ricoh.
Yep. Yeah. And then. Yeah, I ditched that one very good. So you can see also when you're working on a photo project, just keep it consistent. One camera, one lens.
Uh-huh.
So you have a certain aesthetic style.
Voice.
Discovering your
voice.
Discovering
your unique
voice.
Yeah, okay,
voice.
Sounds good. Yeah.
Yeah.
And I can also do another editing workshop in SF and then
unique
in the near futures
and
whatever.
email them
too. Did you guys? Alright, everyone? High fives all around.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'll see you next week.
Oh, yeah.
So,
before we wrap
up,
do I see you next week, David?
No.
Try to go next week.
No.
Nice.
So, before we wrap up, is there any last words that you want to share with the whole group?
Oh, yeah, so it's fine.
Alright.
Words.